Let me introduce the speakers first. This particular, I'm going to make the presentation, but this work wouldn't have been possible but for my teacher, Professor R.P. Gokhan, who has provided the valuable inputs and the design of the ducted propeller. Subir Das, who did the model testing. And the project wouldn't have been possible if Mr. Sahai Raj, the CMD of Shroff Shipyard, wouldn't have taken the risk of trusting in us and going ahead with this new innovative design. And I think all the credit should go to Mr. Sahai Raj for actually taking up the challenge and implementing it. It is all very nice for us to speak on a piece of paper or on a seminar that we can do this, we can do that. But I think all this wouldn't have been possible but for the guts shown by Sahai Raj to get it done or get it implemented. So I once again thank him for this. The background, as you can see, is the mighty river Ganges, a river comparable to Nile, river comparable to Mississippi, Missouri, but highly underutilized. So let us look into it. My contents will start as why inland vessels and inland water transport is a very standard thing I keep repeating every now and then. But more importantly, when is water shallow? How do we define shallow water? And that's very important. And what happens when the water becomes shallow? Because all coastal shipping and inland vessels will move in shallow water. So what are the ways in which we can improve the efficiency? When I mean efficiency, I predominantly mean hydrodynamic efficiency of inland vessels. In a good amount of work we had done in the Department of Naval Architecture in our towing tank, that existing towing tank that we have, on different tunnel shape variants. Then the use of half ducted propeller for the 100 catamaran vessel. This is definitely innovative because normally full ducted propellers are used, but this time we experiment and successfully introduced a half duct propeller. And finally, I would like to conclude by saying the Sagarmala or the Ministry of Shipping has been giving us this opportunity to set up a new seakeeping and maneuvering basin. And I will show you through slide what we are proposing to do. And hopefully it will come out in the next few, in a couple of years time. Now, inland vessel, this is a very standard slide. It is fuel efficient, it is cost effective and environmental friendly. We all know this. And this is a study from World Bank. I think the data is 2 years old, but still the data will be valid. Okay. You can carry water goods on water cheaper. It is more reliable and less polluting. And we know what has been done by European countries and China in this respect. The figures given by World Bank is that inland water transport is at least 30% cheaper than railways and 120% cheaper than the roadways. If you look at it from fuel burning point of view, that is how our carbon emissions are coming up nowadays. 1 liter of fuel can move 24 kilometer on road, whereas it is 85 on rail, but it is approximately 105 ton kilometer if we move it on waterways. Okay. The similar figure can be also looked at. You know, the normal trucks can only carry 16 tons, whereas if you try to move something on a vessel, it can go up to 2000 tons very easily in a 60, 70 meter long vessel. The equivalent of this will be a railway rake, which carries around 40 wagons. And obviously you can understand the length of these wagons, whereas a 60, 70 meter vessel will be good enough to carry. So it is equivalent to 125 trucks or 40 rake wagon. All said and done, as we said, this country is blessed with a very nice coastal waterways stretching up to more than 30,000 kilometers. This is spoken in every forum in this country, and every policymaker keeps stressing this fact. We have a number of waterways, but I will now stress only on two of them right now, the river Ganges and the river Brahmaputra, which is classified as National Waterway 1 and National Waterway 2. The National Waterway 3, which is also very widely used, is the West Coast Canal system that is there. Now, we have declared our waterways, we have declared a coastal policy, but what is our output? Let us look at that and let us understand. If we understand our present situation, then only we can think of improving it. The freight movement in inland waterways, there has been a minor increase. And I will say minor because from around 0.34% in 2003-04, it has definitely gone up to less than 2% around 2018-19. Okay, this is the inland waterway share. Unfortunately, if you compare it with other countries, 45% in Netherlands, even 7.5% in US, and of course, 14% in China, 18% in Vietnam. So we are still less than 2%, and we have never been able to utilize our waterways very effectively. I'm stressing on this point again and again, because even our colonial masters have utilized our waterways much more effectively for getting opium all the way from eastern Uttar Pradesh, using the waterways and shipping it all the way to China, including the indentured labors that they took. And they made full use of the waterways, okay, to basically make profit for themselves, but at least they used the waterways. Now, if you look at every waterway has its own peculiarity, whether it is the Amazon, whether it is Nile, or whether it is Mississippi, Missouri, and we have to understand them. A little bit of study that has been done as far as the National Waterways 1 is concerned, I am trying to show you here that there are at least 4 distinct regions. The first region, and this waterway is from Haldia to Varanasi, as has been declared by government, or Allahabad, but let us stick to Varanasi right now. And most of the infrastructure projects of government are coming up on this particular waterways under what we call the Jal Marg Vikas project of the Prime Minister. From Haldia to Diamond Harbour, you have to take into account wave loads on the vessel. And the class society will not allow you otherwise unless you take the wave loads. Whereas from Diamond Harbour to Triveni, if you travel on the waterways, you get a good draft. Okay, and you don't have waves, but you only have tidal boats once every regular intervals as given, and there are no sharp bends. Once you travel from Triveni to all the way to Farakka, which we have traveled on a catamaran, myself, Mr. Vijit Sarkar also has traveled, the last speaker, you will see there are lots of sharp bends. The LAD, which means least available depth of water, as you can see, comes down. But the worst problem is the pilot doesn't know where the water depth is. There is no demarcation of the line as far as which is the water depth channel. If you cross Farakka, where there is a lock gate, and a new lock gate is being constructed by Government of India, okay, which has been entrusted to Larsen and Toubro, so there will be 2 lock gates which can accommodate vessels up to 125 meter long. Beyond that, there is a problem with the vessel draft, though IWAI says you will get around 3 meter vessel, but what is important here is that there are no sharp bends like you have from Triveni to the North Bengal, that is Farakka. Beyond Patna, it is very difficult to get a draft of the vessel, that much I can tell you. Now the problem is, if you want to move cargo right from Haldia up to Varanasi, you cannot have up and draft going up and down, and that's where the problem comes in the design of these vessels. Okay, what type of vessels is suitable and which region of the river that you are going to exploit. Now, therefore, the question comes, when is water shallow? And if we can understand that, then we can successfully design vessels for both operation and wash mitigation. I'll discuss about wash very shortly, because this is very important. And most of the European countries and other developed countries have taken very strict rules, because if you do not do this wash mitigation, you will have problems as far as shore protection is concerned. Now, definition of a shallow or restricted water was given as long back in 1957 by his famous book of Hydrodynamics in Design by Captain Saunders. Okay, a body of water is considered to be shallow when the boundaries are close enough to affect the resistance or the drag of the vessel, which will have an effect on the speed. When I say attitude, it is trim and sinkage and the maneuvering, compared to a water of unlimited depth. So all these 4 effects will be there, including what we'll see later on is wash. Now, how do we define restriction? The restriction can be defined in terms of depth, which is most predominant. It can also be restricted in terms of width, which is less likely, but most probably it will be a combination of both width and depth. So you will have a depth restriction, at the same time you will have a width restriction. Now, when it comes to depth restriction, we normally take the water or depth divided by the draft of the vessel. Whereas when it comes to width and depth, we take the cross-sectional area of the vessel to the channel cross-section. This is the normal definition, and that's how these 2 ratios have been defined. Now, the shallow water effect in itself will have an issue, as I'll see, and I have tried to explain to you that we have deep water, then we get intermediate, and then we get shallow water. What are the effects? You will see there will be a speed loss. There will be a wave retardation. I'll come to this again. There will be sinkage and trim, that what I told you was attitude. Then you have wash. The waves coming out, mainly the diverging waves coming out from the vessel are the ones that can come up to the shore. They don't decay very quickly, okay, and they create damage. The propulsor is affected because the loading to the propeller will change. The maneuvering I will show you is affected. And in some cases, if you are in coastal waters, the motion also is affected, but the motion is affected in a positive manner, if you look at it in that sense. So if I now bring this in terms of hydrodynamics, you can see here, if it is resistance, what happens? The skin friction increases because of Bernoulli's effect, the flow becomes faster in the channel, and therefore the speed decreases. As far as wave pattern is concerned, the local pressure changes, and therefore the wave angle, what we, as naval architects, what we refer as the Kelvin wave angle, that Kelvin wave angle will change. What you see in deep water, very nice Kelvin wave angle, will not be there. Then you have problems of wash. There is a slow decay of the divergent waves, and this causes damage to the shoreline. If there is also the coast and the moored vessel and anybody taking a bath or trying to enjoy the coastal waters. Then you have a propulsion problem, and the propulsion comes because there is a complete change in the wake pattern. The flow to the propeller changes completely, and therefore the loading to the propeller is changed. And the propeller definitely will not work at its optimum efficiency for which you had designed. Then you have squat, which I have explained to you. There is a hydrodynamic suction at the keel bottom, again because of Bernoulli's effect, and most of the time it will be sinkage and then trim. And we'll see what are the parameters that affect sinkage and trim. Then you have maneuvering, where you have a black flow from the boundary, and what you have is a reduced response. The rudder will not be responding. And if the rudder doesn't respond properly, you have an increase in turning circle diameter. And finally, the motions, where the hydrodynamic arid mass changes, and as I told you, here you will have dampened motion, so in a sense it is perhaps favorable. Now the shallow water effect is extremely important, and we have to understand this, because if you want to move into higher and higher speed vessels, you will have a issue coming up here. And the issue is like this, that if you move in deep water, as you can see from my arrow pointing out here, that you will have the standard Kelvin wave pattern, which I have shown in the top. But as the speed increases and the depth is not increasing correspondingly, we define something called the depth Froude number. We are all familiar with the length Froude number as naval architect, but there'll be a depth Froude number coming up. And if you are moving at the critical speed, which is around 1, what you will have is there will be no more transverse wave. There will only be diverging waves. The problem with this, and beyond the critical speed, you will only get diverging waves and there will be no transverse waves. The problem with the diverging waves are that they are very, very slow decaying waves. They take a long time. They decay slightly faster, as you can see in deep water, but they will decay very, very slowly in shallow water. The decay rate becomes to the power 0.2 or 1 by y to the power 0.2, whereas it is 0.333 out here. The decay rate is very slow. The further problem is when these waves reach the shoreline, okay, what happens is that their wavelength reduces and the wave or amplitude increases. Okay, and this creates further problem. I have just tried to show you a vessel which is moving in a 30-ton vessel only. This is from a Russian book. Which is moving in water, right? And you can see the diverging waves coming. It will take some time before it's coming and trying to harm the shoreline. Now, we have to understand what is happening, and we have to also place our vessel in a proper manner that we don't create this problem. And as I told you, in European countries, there are very strict rules regarding the energy that is washed up to the shore, because the shore gets damaged. Moored vessels get damaged, and people, if they are taking bath or enjoying the coastal waters, they also get hurt in the process. Now, to give a simple example of shallow water for which we have done some work, both CFD and experimental, you can tell, I can show you. If you are working in shallow waters, you have a problem with the draft. You cannot increase the draft much. Now, the normal tendency is to increase the breadth. Now, this is a very dangerous thing in shallow waters, because you see, as you increase the breadth, your squat or the sinkage will increase. And there's every chance that the vessel will get stuck to the bottom. The second thing I have tried to show here on the right-hand side of the slide is, if you increase the breadth by 20%, in a shallow water, your resistance will go up by 64%. Whereas if you reduce it by 10%, your resistance will come down by 10-15%. And as you can see, the more the speed increases, the more is the effect. Which basically means that when you are working with vessels in shallow water, be very careful with the breadth of the vessel. Both have problems in resistance and problems in squatting of the vessel. In deep water, we don't look into this aspect very clearly, because breadth is the cheapest item to increase from operational point of view, and if I look at economics point of view. But here I am forced to increase the length if I want to carry more goods, which has an effect on maneuvering. As I said, the shallow water also has an effect on wake, and I have tried to show some CFD plots which we have worked out here, how the wake itself changes. If the wake changes, then the loading on the propeller will keep changing, and therefore the propeller thrust will keep reducing. And this is another problem that we need to address as far as shallow water vessels are concerned. The next problem that we need to, some of the solutions, I'm also mentioning it out here, is ducted propeller. You can use ducted propeller for such purposes because of the high loading that you will get. We have been working in the department also on something called a tandem propellers. Because you cannot increase the diameter of the propeller, okay, can we put two propellers together with pitch variation, but they're all fixed pitch propellers. And this work has been going on, and we hope we will do some experiments in near future to prove to show what our CFD results we have got. Not only we are working on tandem propellers, we are also trying to put vanes in between the tandem propellers to improve the thrust from the two propellers. This could be a way forward as far as shallow water vessels are concerned. There are other innovative measures, but this is something we have been working on, both the duct and the tandem propeller. Then comes the maneuvering part. As I have tried to show you, when a vessel tries to take a turn and it has a sharp bend, then you need a larger rate, what we call fairway width. A larger width of the fairway is required, otherwise it will get stuck on one of the banks because of the large drift angle out there. Now, the problem here is the larger the radius or the sharper the radius, the more is the dredging you need to do. And this has to, that's what I was trying to tell. If you are working within Triveni to Farakka, the bends are so sharp that if you dredge a narrow channel, it will not work. The vessel will get, and you tend to move longer vessels, and therefore there you have a problem there. So therefore more dredging is required. And here I have tried to show, this is a standard picture, but I have tried to show a vessel which takes a turn of 4 ship length in standard deep water may go up to 8 or 9 ship length in shallow water. The rudder doesn't become very effective. So what are the ways of improving it? One of the ways are, and this is used in the River Rhine, is to use a double-ended or double rudder for each propeller. And if you have a twin screw vessel, you'll end up with 4 rudders. So these are some solutions. There can be solution of both thrusters also, which I have not mentioned. So what I have discussed, I have tried to summarize in these slides, that you have to understand the dimensions of the inland vessel. If you do not get it right, whatever you do, your costing will never come out properly. I have tried to explain the importance of length, breadth, draft, and the speed. And any logistic operator would like his cost of operation to be brought down as far as practicable and the load carrying capacity to go up. Now, this is what I have tried to summarize, that how could we look for solutions, and some of them we have applied in the subsequent design, and which I'll come to it. You have increase in resistance due to shallow water. So one of the possible solution is you put tunnel in way of propellers. There is a reduction in speed. So try to go for higher length to breadth ratios and lower B by T ratios. The loading on propeller will increase. So can you go for tandem propellers? Low propulsive efficiency you will get. So please design the propeller according to the changing wake pattern. Maneuvering, you can use quadruple rudders, wave wash. You can go for catamaran and trimaran, which in our case, we have gone for catamarans. So quickly, I will tell you, we had worked on this tunnel thing in our department, both from CFD analysis and also from towing experiments point of view. And we had looked into various tunnel shapes, which I'm coming to the next slide. And you can see here, this shape is intricate. You have to understand, we had worked on this tunnel shape. What we are doing is, the diameter of the propeller will be more than the draft of the vessel. In other words, in the normal static condition, the propeller will come out of water. But because of the tunnel shape, when the vessel starts moving and the propeller starts emerging, water will be sucked into the tunnel. Once the water is sucked into the tunnel, the propeller will operate in fully submerged condition. This is not a new idea. It has been used in various vessels in the River Rhine. We have taken the idea from them, but what we did is we tried to investigate what could be the best tunnel configuration. And we made a detailed study on this. And my colleagues, Professor Bhattacharya and Mr. Sharad Kumar were involved. And this person who has worked on this, the student, he is now working for shallow water work in Belgium. So there you are. Okay. So you can see some of the modeling that we did. And we looked into what tunnel shape is best. So not only we did a CFD study to see that proper water is getting sucked in and propeller is fully immersed, we also did a model experiment with the ducted propeller in this. And these are the results we got. What I'm trying to say is that by doing this tunnel, we actually managed to reduce the viscous pressure drag in the fully loaded condition. But in the lower bar chart, if you see, there was not much improvement in the ballast condition. But definitely there is an improve. So if you are designing cargo ship, this is something which you can keep in mind, that in fully loaded condition, there is a decrease in the viscous pressure drag. Now, the ideas that we got, we tried to implement this in the Shoff shipyard vessel, which is a 100 passenger catamaran vessel, which they got for the Brahmaputra River. That's why I'm written National Waterways 2. And they also had a problem. If you see this, it is a catamaran design, so that will reduce your wash. Then if you see the draft of the vessel, it was restricted to 0.75 meters. Now, if I put a propeller of 0.5 meter, I can assure you it was very difficult to get at that power. I can take a challenge also on there. If you try to put a propeller of 0.5 meter and try to achieve that particular speed, it was very difficult because they had to give a 10 knot speed as far as the requirements were concerned. So we worked on this, and I think, as I said very in the initial beginning, I'm grateful to Professor Gokhan to come up with the idea. The tunnel shape we worked on, but then he came up with the idea. We did an experiment in our towing tank. There are a lot of things I would like to mention here, but let us not say. We did the experiment with demi hull, and lockdown took place. We could not access our lab, but Mr. Saharaj had to deliver the vessel. So we worked on empirical methods. After the lockdown was opened, then we could only do the test from the trials. So here you can see the demi hull, and here you can see the catamaran, and here you can see the interference effect that is taking place. This is very important for us too. Both of them are more or less at the design speed. Now, this is where the innovation came in, that Professor Gokhan suggested that we can go for a half duct. And I can show you that Mr. Sahai Raj took up the idea. We did a calculation using Kaplan propeller and half duct, and we had the resistance test, and accordingly it was designed. Some of the images of half duct I'm showing you. The top portion was taken by the tunnel and the half duct. The diameter of the propeller is 0.835. I'll show you in the next slide. You can see here the diameter of the propeller is 0.835, whereas the draft of the vessel is 0.75. Now, with this wider or larger diameter of the propeller, we could achieve a much higher efficiency. And here I have shown you the graphs, which these are the results from the model test that we had done. Okay, I'm not getting into details of this. Why I have plotted this is, if you look at my blue line, this is the empirical data that I gave to Professor Gokarn because we could not do the catamaran test because of the lockdown. So he designed the propeller accordingly. But after we could do the catamaran test, the propeller had to be redesigned. And Sahai Raj was brave enough to say that we'll go ahead with this. If required, I'll change the pitch of the propeller, which he did. Okay. And accordingly, he changed the pitch of the propeller after we gave him the results from the model test of the catamaran, which was much more accurate than the empirical results. So this is the Kaplan propeller he had we had manufactured and designed. I'm giving you the basic details here. You can see here, the brake power of the engine is hardly 134 kilowatts. Engine RPM is 2100. Okay. The pitch of the propeller is close to 1. Okay, the propeller diameter is 0.835 and the nozzle is 19A. Now, what is important is when we took this is the engine performance curve. When he took the vessel for trial, if you see the asterisk mark here, this is the what we call the trial results. So around 2050, we could get around 10 knots speed. The speed is coming from the red line, which is it is multiplied by 10. So we could get around 10.2 knots speed. When he took the propeller to 2100 RPM, we could get around 11 knot speed. So we wanted 10 knot speed, but if you move the propeller at 2100, we were able to get around close to 11 knots speed. Okay. This was possible only because we could go for a larger diameter propeller and with only 134 kilowatt of engine power that was given to us. Okay. And this is what I say when we try to optimize things, this is what can be done. Three of these vessels have been delivered. There are 10 in the pipeline, and I am showing you some pictures of them. These are the pictures which Mr. Sahai Raj has sent me from the mighty river Brahmaputra, and you can see the vessels in operation out there. Okay. I am not showing you the picture where the Chief Minister has inaugurated all these things, but hopefully 10 of them will be put in place. Is meant to carry 100 passenger, 100 motorcycles. Okay. Now, before I conclude, I think I started a bit late, but I should be having this 2 minutes time. There is a lot of work to be done in shallow water. There's a lot of work to be done in coastal waters, and they require a different engineering, or they require a different engineering compared to what we require for deep water. And therefore, we have been lucky enough that the Ministry of Shipping, the Sagarmala Cell, has given us project grant worth around 69 crores to development of coastal inland and maritime technology by providing research and development inputs to the industry, by providing efficient design solution, and also for providing consultancy services. Now, the existing towing tank where we have done all these experiments is a narrow towing tank. Where we can only do tests for deep water and we can only do tests for resistance and propulsion. We cannot do tests for maneuvering. If you want to do tests for maneuvering, then you need a wider tank. And therefore, keeping this in mind, we have now designed and hopefully we'll start building this tank. I'm showing you some images of this particular tank, which is right now artist impression. Hopefully it will come up. But the uniqueness of this particular tank is that you can vary the water depth from 0.5 meters to 3.5 meters to simulate the right shallow water condition that is needed. Now to do that, and this tank, our existing tank is 4 meter wide. This tank is going to be 16 meters wide so that we can do the maneuvering experiments both in deep water and in shallow water, including seakeeping experiments. And therefore, the special purpose of this particular thing is we have got this carriage, which of course can move in the X direction, but it also has a movement in the vertical direction so that we can simulate the right depth of water. And it also has a movement in the Y direction and a rotary movement, which is required for maneuvering tests. So right now we are working on getting the civil structure done, and hopefully we'll also get the mechanical and the electronics part to be done. I am talking to a wider community of marine engineers out here. I am expecting that this is a very challenging task that we have got. I require your support and help if you can give me in any manner regarding the construction and fabrication of this particular complicated structure which has to be made as per world standard so that we can give output also up to world standard. So I'm appealing to my broader community, the naval architects and marine engineering community, that please do associate with us in this particular manner to see what best we can do and what we can offer as far as the impetus in this area is concerned. So with these few words, I would like to conclude my presentation. I have given the references from where I have picked up most of the material. And once again, thank you. The emails are given of both Mr. Saharaj. You can contact him regarding the vessel, regarding the half duct. Professor Gokhan, for everything naval architecture, you can contact. Okay. And I'm here in the Department of Naval Architecture, IIT Kharagpur. I will also be able to help you out with any queries that you have in this matter. So once again, INMEX, thank you very much for allowing me to make this presentation. I hope I have not exceeded the time. I know I think I have done for a few minutes, but that should be manageable. Thank you very much. Do I unshare my presentation?
Yeah, that would be good. Thank you so much, Dr. Sir. No, the timing is fine. We have had a really interesting session. And personally for me, I have actually... could you switch on your video, sir?
Yeah,
perfect.
Thank you. Thank you very much, sir, for so, allowing me this opportunity.
No problem. So my question, I mean, for me personally, I now understood for the first time, you know, I always wonder why barges on in Antwerp and in Amsterdam in the Netherlands, you know, had that particular long shape. And
yes,
for the, that's right. Today you have
you need to have a long L by B ratio. Yes. You cannot increase the breadth, which we don't understand people who have been doing deep water vessel designs.
Correct. Exactly. So that's a huge understanding for me.
And the effect on resistance is drastic, actually. Okay. It should be quantified. And that's what I'm trying to tell people. Okay. Even a 10% increase in breadth will have a drastic effect both on squat and resistance.
Correct. There's a question from Vineet Patura. It asks, will the testing model cater for changes in water density? Change in density changes the trim and sinkage.
No. Can I answer the question?
Yes, please. Go ahead.
The answer is like this. There is a standard, something called the International Towing Tank Convention or Committee, which is comprised of towing tank all over the world. Okay. And we have set standards there. It's like IMO. If you look at it from towing tank test point of view. So the rule is that you test always in fresh water.
Okay.
And if you, when you extrapolate to full scale, you take the correction for viscosity and density into account.
Okay.
The standard practice is always to have fresh water in the tank, measure the temperature, but when we extrapolate, then we extrapolate, and that's a standard procedure which is followed by the entire towing tank community all over the world.
The next question is from Sanjay Verma. And it says, since no good infrastructure is available on the National Waterways 2 for shipbuilding, how do shipbuilders launch vessels when the water level recedes, as the water levels are low for 7 months?
I wish Mr. Saharaj would have been here. I'll tell you the reason why I'm saying. His shipyard is located in Gujarat, in Bharuch.
Right.
And he got these orders for this vessel, which is in National Waterways 2.
Right.
His infrastructure is in Gujarat. Perhaps another presentation will tell you how this vessel was constructed by blocks, shifting the blocks from Bharuch to Assam, Guwahati or Pandu, and assembling it out there and launching it in water. I have some slides for that, which he has sent me. Okay. But he is the right person to answer because of COVID, I could not go there. Because of the restrictions. My idea was to go there and see how he was putting it in water. Okay. And I wish in a future seminar, we should request Saharaj to tell him how he built the infrastructure in Pandu.